These are the ruins of Nan Madol, home of the god king Izokalekl, a man who famously tore off his own genitalia in a way that kind of makes sense. It's 19 square miles and over 1,000 years old. It's an unthinkable number of perfectly shaped giant basalt slabs fit together like some Tetris of the gods. It is no less impressive than a pyramid of Giza. And it was built by a people still in the Stone Age. A society who total barely numbered 30,000. They call it Nan Madol. And it's one of the most impressive places on Earth. It's a genuine world wonder. And yet, pretty much everything we know about it is a lie. Or, at the very least, a half-truth. Because it exists in Micronesia, on the island of Pompeii, where beyond their tattoos, there was no written language. And so the history that we use to understand this wonder is effectively little more than myth. Echoes, all but lost to the near-complete destruction of the people who were born to hear them. Which makes finding any real truth here kind of complicated. Let me explain. To learn the origin story of this island, I read 11 different myths from 9 different scholarly sources. That's the maximum number I could find available online in English. I was also told the story twice in person by friends I'd made while filming, so that's 13 total for those keeping count. But within those, only 8 or so contained clear overlapping themes. The other 5 were completely different in every respect. Different names, different plots, different symbols. So how would you tell that story? How would you express that truth? The way I'm going to do it is essentially the way it's always been done. I'm gonna wander through those stories as I see fit. I'm gonna pick and choose in a way that makes the most sense to me, and then I'm gonna pass that off to you as the truth. But please understand that it isn't. Because this is Nan Madol. It's just an echo. Let's go back to the very beginning. Genetic and linguistic studies suggest that the island of Pompeii was settled by what were likely descendants of Taiwanese aboriginals. It's a cultural group known as the Austronesians. They likely invented one of the most important ships in all human history, the proa. Through this incredible invention, those Austronesians spread from their primeval homeland to colonize nearly a third of the planet. They traveled into the Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia, Brunei. Their ships were so advanced so early that they settled Madagascar before even the East Africans could. Their cultural influence once stretched from Japan to Africa to Patagonia. But today I'm focusing on the Pacific, where they spread out in 3 distinct waves. The first were the Melanesians, who mixed with the native Papuans. The second, the Micronesians, who settled the smaller islands to the north. And finally, the Polynesians, who were perhaps the greatest navigators of all time. It's the second group who I'm focusing on today, specifically those Micronesians who settled the island of Pompeii. This is their story. Thousands of years ago, some say the very dawn of time, riding a canoe launched from the west, a great navigator named Sapikini was sneaking off to heaven. Or perhaps it was a married couple, or maybe 16 villagers. But whoever they were, those adventurers would meet a magical octopus who would point them to a small spit of coral, or perhaps sand, breaching up over the surface of the waves. In their language, they would name this Pon. And on it, they would build a stone altar, or as they called it, Pei. And on this mythical platform, they would lay the soil of their homeland and call down from the sky the mountains that would become the island of Pompeii. The first colonist to ever step foot on this great stone altar would bring fruit seeds and taro. The second, soil from their homeland in the south. The third would bring housing, the fourth, roofs. The fifth would bring fire, then banana and yams. And the last to arrive, not even human, just a lonely coconut washed ashore all by itself. And some of those legends would claim that these colonists would be met by an already existing population, people they would call natives. Others would say it was empty entirely, but with this new land now prosperous, the great goddess Limwetu would call forth her children from their home on the mythical island of Eir, and arriving on Pompeii, they would form the first clan, known as the Dipwindmen. Thus would begin the period that modern Pompeians now refer to as the Great Peopling. Over thousands of years, every inch of this island would eventually become populated, every region divided, even the deepest jungle interior, a landscape forever associated with witchcraft and death, would herald the arrival of these incoming Austronesians. And at some unknown point, those waves of humanity would begin praying to an avian thunder god, a figure of ritual and sacrifice that would forever be associated with this island's nativity. Elsewhere on the planet, Alexander would conquer Persia. Rome would rise and fall. But here on the island of Pompeii, entire generations would pass without so much as a memory. Until one day, that period of peopling was over, and now would begin the period of power. In the East, a slow centralization of religion had started to offer an opportunity never before experienced by a Pompeian. With an increased population came an increased reliance on agriculture, and with that need for rain came the fear of the sun. And from that fear, a desire to control, to placate that great goddess of the harvest, a universally desired blessing that could be traded endlessly for those three donations of fruit, fish, and labor, which shattered native society. Because within that traditional Pompeian system, labor was an extremely hard thing to obtain. Work had long been split into two categories, light and heavy. Light work referred to war, commitment to a raid for your chief, whereas heavy, the more expensive of the two, meant toil. The amount that one would have to pay to even obtain a small amount of that heavy work was nearly impossible given the nature of this society, which kind of put those priests in a unique position. Because for the first time in all Pompeian history, someone had the power to obtain that sustained labor from the masses. It was something that secular leaders had up until that point no capacity to do, because their resources were finite. But unlike breadfruit, fish, and daughters to marry, blessings can never run thin. And although nobody truly knows for certain, I presume this happened in the East because those were the tribes that had been granted an unraidable symbol of immense power. They were the closest to the rising sun. And with the donated labor that was naturally divined to them from that symbol, they would start a great temple reaching out towards it. It was built out over the reef, understandably a holy place where all tribes traveling in their great canoes could deliver the tribute that put them right by that god. It was built as far to the east as anything could be in the Pompeian universe, and the light of the sun would touch that temple first every day forever. And the more it grew, the more spiritual power would become associated with it as a physical location. It wasn't just a place as well, it was an idea. These were the stones that allowed for taxation. Everyone on the island agreed. If you wanted to please the gods, you'd have to please the men who controlled this temple. And so naturally, it wasn't long before someone decided to just take it. They call these conquerors the Saudalur, which effectively just translates to rulers of Pompeii. But oddly enough, the songs that many sing about them don't actually tell of conquest, which frankly makes me question who wrote those songs. In fact, the most commonly told story in Pompeii today is that Nan Madol was not taken, but rather built by the first Saudalur. That the origins of this temple came from the divine twins Olosipa and Olosopa, magicians of a great eel god, a god that was proposed to be even more powerful than the thunderbird of the interior. It was their dragon, their giant eel, who would help lift the stones of Nan Madol into place. Others say that they got the help of giants, or they were perhaps giants themselves. I was even told you can still see their giant footprints to this very day, although nobody could actually tell me where. Legends say that these twins flew in from the west, that they were foreign and had green skin like the ocean, which some have suggested means that they came from the Solomon Islands, although conventional wisdom today says that they probably came from the Sokays. It's a part of Pompeii originally named for the supposedly foreign-speaking people who'd lived there for generations, hundreds of years before this point. And whether that's true or not, whether they did come from that part of Pompeii, it is definitely where the granite came from. We know that for certain. Which makes me feel like I should mention that foreignness equating to great importance is the one thing that was shared among every myth I read from Pompeii. If you wanted to be important to this culture, it was almost imperative that you come from abroad. Which, although perhaps it's totally unrelated, kind of makes me think of the episode we did on the Hmong in Laos, where revolutionary religious leaders were mythologized as foreign. There, it was a symbolic way of saying that they had no clan affiliation, no political problems that could stem from being part of an existing tribal network. It gave them the freedom to be something more, a true savior, the perfect vessel for change. And perhaps that's what the myths here mean as well. Or maybe those conquerors actually were just from the Solomons. It's impossible to say. But regardless of the reasons why, the stories here tend to claim that when Olisipa died of old age, his twin Olisopa became the first true ruler of Pompeii, or as they called it, the Sa Dolor. And with that crown secured, he'd marry a native Pompeian and sire 16 demigod children, some of which would be sent to different parts of this island to form its first tribal aristocracy. And from that point on, this society would no longer exist in that anarchy of the great peopling, but be ruled through a form of centralized feudalism. Its labor would be organized not just around the temple, but its king. And those successive Sa Dolor would rule over this temple for the next 600 years, or in the folk memory, this is represented as 8 distinct rulers, each of whom would grow the great temple that much further, until it eventually came to stretch 19 square miles over this reef. To reference that, it's 100 times the size of the Vatican. And this is with a population under 30,000 to do all of this unthinkable amount of labor. Which is no doubt why, by the 8th and final Sa Dolor, the stories tell of a people taxed to the bone. They tell of sadism and torture, of cannibalism and patricide. They tell of an eel god who, even after 600 years of forced conversions, could never quite penetrate that interior. But as their rulers became intolerable, it seemed as if the island itself began to shake them off. The Thunderbird, long since repressed by that eel, would give birth to a bastard with the Sa Dolor's wife. His name was Izo Kalekel. And in the early 1600s, just after the first contact with Europeans, he would be smuggled away from this island and symbolically turned into a foreigner, given that symbolic power. When he returned to reclaim these lands, it was not from the west like those before him, not like the Sa Dolor, but from the east, like the sun. Some say he represents an invasion from the island of Kosh Rai. And to that theory's credit, Layla does contain a powerful eastern temple in mimic of Pompeii. They were certainly culturally twinned, so it's not impossible, I suppose. Others suggest he came from as far away as the Kiribati, a royal bastard hidden so far from his homicidal relatives that he could never be found. But those with the most convincing arguments claim that calling him foreign was just a way of making his rise fit the traditions of this island's power. Yet, foreign or not, every step Izo Kalekel took further showed his deep connection to this land. For example, on his return, he circled the island clockwise, which was an omen of great power here. It's also, coincidentally, the path one would have to take to raise an army if they ever intended to invade Nan Madol. Another example is off the coast of Kichi, on the spiritually important atoll of Ant. Izo Kalekel was said to have married a local noblewoman and been given the traditional breadfruit seed that one eats before battle. It's a symbolic way to say that this war was the will of the people, that he wasn't a conqueror, but a liberator. Which again makes me question, who wrote these stories? The rest of the myth, however, reads a bit like a palace drama. Despite all the omens of war he received on the way, when Izo Kalekel arrived at Nan Madol, he was treated as an honored guest, not an invader, like one would do to a long-lost family member. They threw a great feast and treated him with the respect, or as they call it, wahoo, that any truly noble person would deserve. But as time went on and their children began to fight, it spread to their parents and began a civil war. And those legends say that at first the Sa Dolor looked like they were going to win that war, with Izo Kalekel in full retreat. But one of his lieutenants shoved a spear into his own foot to say, "I will not take one more step back," and it rallied the troops and they took the kingdom. The 8th and final Sa Dolor would turn into a fish, where he inhabits the streams of Pompeii to this day. With ultimate power now in his hands, that newly crowned Izo Kalekel would marry his sister. Everyone then would understand that this was something only a god could survive, that something so taboo would kill a normal man, and therefore it showed that he must be divine. But weakened by that civil war and owing a great deal to those who'd won him his crown, no matter how powerful his magic had been, how divine he was, this new ruler was soon forced to divide that authority among his subjects. Put another way, He decentralized the feudalism of the Sa'adallur and created a system of independent lords known as the Nanken and Namwarki, a system that survives to this very day. Each region would therefore be given their own supreme ruler, and their power would be derived from the spiritual blood of Izokalekul rather than the physical location of the temple he controlled. All of them would be his symbolic children, rulers who would no longer be subject to the taxes of Nan Madol, but rather to those of their own clan. And within 100 years, that great temple city that had ruled this island for longer than the Empire of Rome existed would be all but deserted. They say that it wasn't long afterwards that Izokalekul himself would die. With his work done and people pacified, he caught his reflection in a pool near the temple and realized that he was growing old. And he decided that no people should be ruled by a man with gray hair, so he bent down a tall palm tree, tied a rope around his genitals, and used it like a catapult to tear it all off, which, in Pompeian society, showed just how divine he must have been. This was an act of a true god, because in their world, the more pain you could take, the greater a person you were. So in a way, tearing your dick off was the most masculine thing that anyone could ever do. And bleeding out in what would soon become the ruins of the greatest city that the Pacific ever saw, Izokalekul died a legend. Some would even say a myth. This is Nan Madol, and this is Rare Earth.